Arnold Richman.
Otherwise known as Barney.
Otherwise known as Barney?
Yeah.
Where did that come from then?
God knows.
So shall I call you Barney?
Yeah.
Okay, Barney. Right.
I only get called Arnold if I've done something wrong. Mother used to call me Arnold.
Right, so it's Barney.
And I know I was in trouble.
So how long have you been here?
I've never been here. I'd normally say since I was born, but yeah, it's 1950.
Right, okay.
When I was born. Born in Bridger. Family, generations, built the place back in 1820s.
1820?
Known as the Squatter's Cottage. Hence the shape of the roof behind us being out of square, end of it. And it's in line with that edge there, you go straight down to that edge down there. Long narrow strip of garden crossway. You built the place, you know, if you could build out of the place and have a fire burning within 24 hours or something, you could claim it's your own.
And that's how they came in?
That's how they reckon this place come. There's a lot of places around here like that.
And your family's been here ever since?
Ever since. I've got records in there, bootmakers, carpenters, all sorts of that.
So, when did you first start hedging?
Well, I used to go out with my father when I was a toddler. I used to, you know, mother would get fed up with me, and I used to go out with father, and he'd be out there doing it. Well, from what I gather, when father come here in 47, all these hedges around the fields and they out over that way. This old blooming great road right up all over the hand, lying. He'd do a field every other year, lying. Steep it down and, you know, and then cut out all the big wood for firewood and any big trees, they'd come out for firewood that was, you know, no good. And he'd dig out the foot of the hedge around and put the cast set up on the top and usually then plough the field and, you know, reseeding or turn to, you know, corn or a crop or something like that. Granny Irby out after picking sloes and blackberries and whatever I could make and either making the jams or wine or, you know, that sort of stuff, right?
They're still doing that today.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
It's nuts and these sort of things. There was never remember a great lot of nuts on the edges and that, like. There used to be in the hazelnuts, you get the odd place, odd tree or two with that, or bush or two with that on, right? But, not even, never great, no, I never remember mother, father, granny, or anybody picking any of they, like. I think they used to think they were a squirrel, probably anybody's teeth ones a good bat then, could crunch the damn things up.
So what sort of tools were used then? Because now it's all chainsaws, and you've got the flails and the cutters and the trimmers. What sort of tools would they have used when they were doing it by hand?
For sort of doing the small stuff, what they call a bushman, they have a bolt saw, that type of thing for the small stuff, and felling trees, I've been on the end of that damn thing more than once, is what they call a crosscut saw, the thing about 6 foot long, and one person goes one end, and the other goes the other, and when he's really cutting, he's singing, the thing is. Ring, ring, going through the timber like. Well, you know, if it didn't cut in, just even pulling your guts out. And, no, I was glad when chainsaws come along. It's very hard.
Hard work.
Yeah, hard work. You spend like, my old father used to say, there's two eats with this. One when you're cutting the darn stuff, another one when you sit him beside of it. Well, then there was like used to call a bracing hook. It is an ordinary oak, but he's built stronger. A stronger built oak, you know, for covering the bigger stuff. And he'd have like a leather cuff on him, which was one of the things you went to the local bootmaker and said, I want a bit of leather put around here, like, and sort of you roughly drawed it out for him, so I can put my hand in here and I shan't get blackthorns and that. And then he'd have another thing on his knee, like a great big leather knee protector that you could kneel on stuff to hold it down while she was strapping it down, and a little hatchet or axe, you know, used to be always there, but, you know, it's just a lot easier to use, you know, if you're steeping stuff over, you'd use the axe, like, you don't want to make a cut, you want to make more of a, you know, a splitting to it, like, but, various tools like that. But I totally disagree with one thing about, this is another little single form pine with 8-year rule on, about trimming every 3 years. Mr. Blackbird jumps in the tree, he nip edge that, don't I? And he thinks, oh, this is nice. 3 years later, 2 years later, he thinks, this is even better. 3 years later, and he's gone, this is getting proper. 4 years later, he thinks, what the hell have happened? Where's it all gone? But be just trimming it nicely. This is what happens, yours just gets trimmed nicely every year, just tipped off, and it leaves a lovely thick edge. And if you don't trim it every, if you leave it for 3 years and not trim it, it tends to go all the way to the bottom again. But there's stuff that grows down there, if it's trimmed every year, there's stuff down the bottom and keep, that'll stay, sort of stay there, like. But when you get a load of canopy on the top, as you know, underneath don't grow.
So when did you start hedging then?
Well, as soon as I left school, basically. You know, I was about 15. That'd be 1960.
Right.
To be the old-fashioned way then, but...
Yeah.
And very slow, because now, you know, mechanical means it can be done in a few hours, a stretch of hedge that would take you all winter, basically.
Yeah, and that's when you would work with the hedges, is it, in the winter?
Yes, that's right. That would be the ideal thing. You'd wait sort of late October. You know, you're thinking about the cows lying indoors, and you know, all the other jobs have been done, the mangles, the potatoes, and then you think, well, let's start doing an edge. And of course, you know, that would be very time consuming then, but that could last you all winter doing one edge, basically.
Mm-hmm.
But prior to that, before I came along, people would let the edge go up deliberately to use the wood for their wood indoors, you know, all the small bits be used for the bread oven, and the bigger bits to keep your house warm. You know, it was a rotation.
So what was the rotation?
Well, you know, to let that edge go up for so many years, and then cut them off, and then, you know, do a couple of years, and that would keep you supplied with wood, and all the other bit. You know, they used to make a writ of packets that would specially be used to put in the bread oven, you see. And then they used to see a rick made up specially with packets of wood, what we would call packets. You see, we don't see that anymore. It was just being phased out as I was, you know, in the 50s, when I can remember, basically.
So how did they tie the packets?
Ah, yeah, that's right. I think sometimes they would twist the easel. Derek Cook would know better than me, in actual fact. And but I suppose you could tie, but I think they would tie easel and twist it, I don't know. Like they would have sparsed it, but he would know better than I would. But lots of farms I'd go into in the early 50s as a small boy and see it. But the mid-60s come, it all phased, farming moved on at such a pace then. The first lot of wire we bought would have been, I'd say about 1970. Prior to that, you didn't need any. We hadn't got any rules of wire. And now it's just constant till you finish up virtually wiring every edge that you've got. If you're going to keep stock in numbers, everything needs to be wired.
Mm.
Otherwise, it's not going to be there the next day.
Yes.
Yeah, when I left school, it was just my father and I. But prior to that, I suppose late 40s, early 50s, some farms, about 100 acres, would have two men there. But it soon got to that, you know, they weren't, you know, able to afford them. So in time 1970, you know, the numbers had got right down, and things that needed doing weren't being done. You know, that was the thing. The labour after, I suppose, the Second World War soon melted away, you know. Each decade came, there was less and less people working there. You know, incredible.
Mm.
Small birds have... Lately, I'm a little bit, you know, concerned, really, because their numbers have dropped a bit. And of course, you don't hear the cuckoo very often like you used to, you know. But we did hear it a couple of years ago, but regarding to some birds like the barn owl, that number have actually increased in the last 10 years. Yeah, and the buzzards, their numbers are way brilliant, you know. But other birds like the lapwing that you'd see breeding in the 50s, and the curlew and things like that, don't see them here now, apart from in the winter time you'll see the lapwing come in, but they used to breed here on the farm one time. But a lot of other small birds, especially the skylark, the numbers have dropped off pretty bad, really.
Any ideas why?
Well, probably, you know, the early cutting of silage and whatnot could have affected a bit. Like the grey part, which you don't see that one no more, you know. But it's not good, and they all seem to think that, like the greenfinch and some of those sort of birds, there's some disease they picked up through bird feeding or something. I don't know. It didn't all down to farming practices, you know, what else caused it, but...
So, what makes a Devon Hedge different from other parts of the country?
Well, when you're looking at a Devon Hedge, you're looking at so many different styles of hedges. So, if we like to start off here on Dartmoor, the first thing we come to is a stone wall, a dry stone wall, which is simply wall stones packed one on top of the other with no infilling whatsoever, just stone upon stone upon stone. And that is your dry stone walls. And then when you come down into the fields, a lot of the hedges on our fields are faced with stone, but between the two faces of the stone, of the wall, hedge, or call it what you will, it's been infilled with earth, and then you will find on the top of it vegetation. Then when you go further down through in country, as we call it, you'll get the Devon Hedge of the form of being purely turf, like a bank, and sort of with no stones in it at all, but again with vegetation on top. And then even when you get down close to the sea, if you go down somewhere like Tor Cross, you'll find one or two unusual hedges down there which are made from great big slate slabs stood up on their edge, like a lot of headstones in a row. So the variety of hedges that you'll find in Devon, here in this parish, we've got some examples of medieval hedges with the old strip system. Now, people were allowed a piece of land, so you had some ground up which was high and dry, and ran down to the river, so that you had water. So a lot of cottagers had strip fields, and those then eventually became parted up, and the hedges were created in different ways. As I was saying earlier on this farm, most of the hedges are two faces of stone. Again, the stone would have been got out of the ground in the process of ploughing and cultivating the ground. You plough up stones, you dig up stones, and they would be used to make the hedges. So the practical use is phenomenal. And there are things in hedges which so many people never notice. For instance, there's a thing called a creeple in hedges. And we've got one or two on our farm. And what it is, it's a piece of... The hedge has been built with a hole in the hedge, which is perhaps 2 foot wide, and we'll say 3 foot high. And then across the top is a big stone, and then the rest of the stone, the hedge is built on top of it. And this was done to allow sheep to move from one field to the next, but not cattle. And the same applies, you'll find some of these creeples on the hedges that face the open moorland, so that the farmer would let his sheep run out and in, but the ponies and on the moor, they couldn't get in. And then if you want, you simply had a big stone beside it so that you could block it off at any one time. Mm. And so you get these things in hedges. There's nothing more I enjoy than looking at gateposts. And when you look at gateposts, you can see the whole history of how a gate has altered in 200-300 years.
And they always planted each bank now that's stoned out, they planted it all one species, each hedge, because then the farmer would know where to go to get material for what he wanted. Over the years, natural species of trees have colonized the hedge. So, to work out the age of a hedge, if you walk 30 paces and count the species in that hedge, well-established species, you can be pretty sure that each species represents 100 years.
So we've got some very old hedges.
We've got some very old hedges. Mm. Some of them 1,000 years old. Mm. But they've been maintained time and time, generation after generation. They've been laid, the banks have been put up periodically where they were eroding away. Otherwise put up with turf, called casting, or put up with stone, what they call locally ditching. So when we take a hedge, the hedge belongs to me, I feel. So the farmer doesn't come near me, he probably goes down out to look when we've gone home, but he leaves it to me. So I feel this farmer's got to leave this hedgerow to somebody one day, and it'll still be here, but while I'm working on it, it belongs to me, and I'll do the best job I can to preserve and keep that hedge well for the future.
Because when you started hedging, labour was cheap. There was a lot of labour on the farms. And that is a big issue now, isn't it?
I worked on a farm when I left school. They had 7 men hedge-laying all the winter. 7. Mm. And they had a wooden caravan. They used to drag around with the tractors at their luncheon.
And
they were just
how
maintaining hedges, doing stonework, round the gates, putting gates in, laying hedges, casting up banks all the winter.
And
7 men
how many,
on a 500-acre farm.
How many hours in a day would they have worked?
8.5 hours.
What,
6 days a week? 5.5 days. You'd have to work till 12 o'clock on Saturday to make you 48 hours a week.
And do you know how much they would have earned?
Well, when I went to live in on a farm, my wages, equivalent today, was £1.20 a week.
And what was
when I got married in 1963, my wages was £8.
And what was a pint of cider or a loaf of bread?
Cider was 9 pence, old nine. But food was still dear in those days. When I worked on the farm, in the farm cottage, when I got married first, my £8, I paid the butcher that came around in a van, the baker came around in a van, and a grocer van used to come around, one you could walk inside, like a self-service van, to get all. We never went to town. All my wages went on those 3 items. I had free rent, no rates. I could bring home from the farm eggs in the morning and cream and milk. And I had a supply of firewood. So the perks of the job, it was a good life, but there was nothing over. You say you just made the best of what you had. I think when I got married first, I was happier than I'd ever been. We used to walk to the nearest village, 4 mile, to go to the Saturday night dance, and walk back. The dance would be in the village hall, but we'd go in the pub first, another 3 pints, and then go in the dance. And I'd only been married a short time.
And then you'd stagger back?
Well, we'd walk back in the main line. The main line's quite romantic, really, I suppose. I was happy then, but we had nothing. Really, no material thing.
If you were hedging, yeah, it would be like you and this is Steve, isn't it?
That's
Well,
just the two of you working on it?
Well, Stephen would probably went down there when he come to work, you know. And I would go down there after, in the autumn time, after I'd done the cattle, fed the cattle, you know, in the mud. I can't quite remember if Stephen did go straight down the edge, you know, working.
I think I can remember him saying that he did with that particular hedge. He was down there early in the morning because James had come to photograph him, and he was surprised that James was there so early in the morning.
you can always see a little bit of mist.
So, yes, I think sort he of. Said that it was, one point it was quite frosty as well. You know, it was quite, 8 o'clock in the morning, it's early when you're sitting, when you're working outdoors.
Yeah.
That's right. That edge went for there, there was a corner there. And then went up the way, see, for, like I said, the uphill was about four and a half acres, was it, something like that. The field wasn't on one very big years ago, so that's why the people wanted they just pushed down.
I think we're, as part of this project, we've got a photographic exhibition. And I think some of, I don't know about these, but I think this one we have permission to include some of the photographs.
Yes, and as I say, that one was used in the Devon Life when the letter was included asking for people for information about Devon Hedges, and that's where I read it, you see. As soon as I saw that photo, being so familiar, it meant that I then read the letter. So it was quite an attraction in that sense.
For the tape, I suppose we ought to say we're looking at the Hedges lunch break, Stephen Squire at Dalton in 1980. That's the one we're discussing, aren't we?
Yes.
Absolute classic, isn't it? Beautiful.
What do you say? Old for the day. I don't think so, as time goes on. You know, if you can make things easier, why not, compared to today, wouldn't it?
Yeah. It would, yeah. Rather, but yeah. You enjoyed hedging, though? Did you enjoy it?
Oh, yes, you know, when it's just a thing to do, you don't take no much notice of it, you know. I mean, if you was doing something you nobody thought was worth doing, it would be a different thing.
A sense of pride.
Yeah, you know, and like Stephen there, I suppose he enjoyed doing it, you know. And it's not only sometimes enjoying doing it, enjoy looking at what you've done, you know.
Sense of achievement.
Yeah.
So, when you're managing your hedges now, are you doing it as your father would have done it?
No, because my dad, as I say, his idea would to be to see a neat and tidy hedge, which involved trimming every year, either with an old-fashioned finger mower like we used to have to trim the hedges back, or more recently with a flail trimmer. And what we were finding, we were getting very gappy hedges, and the sheep would be underneath the bushes. So we were sort of growing up a metre tall, and then you were left with a stalk and just bushy stuff on the top.
So how are you doing yours? What tools are you using?
My hedge laying is mostly done with a chainsaw and an axe. The main two tools I use.
Don't use the old billock. And what about tying steeps? Do you use string or the old crooks? What do you use?
Originally, when I started, because a lot of the bushes were so short, or or that they were sort of stumpy growth, that there wasn't a lot to hold it down, I would have used baler twine. But now I find with the hedges having grown up that I can keep it down with the spikes and spears. No string is being used at all.
Going back, do you think the hedges now look different to when you were growing up?
Oh yeah, certainly. Certainly there is a vast difference in the hedges that we have got now. In height, and particularly in height, where we're quite exposed to wind coming off the coast or from the southwest. It does make quite a difference from a shelter point of view. And also the amount of berries that we get on our hedges, which before you wouldn't have seen, because they're all being flowed down.
So that's a big improvement now with the berries and everything for the wildlife. So do you think the wildlife is better now?
I would say there's an increase of winter birds particularly. It's not unusual to walk down through a hedge and see a whole flock of birds come out of the hedge. I can remember leaving school. One of the jobs I did was with a little hedge trimmer on the back of the tractor, which you would go around, trim your hedges. You would then go around with a pitchfork and scrape it out into piles and put it on the trailer and take it away and burn it, because there was nothing there of any value.
So you're now, in a way, you're farming the hedge, aren't you?
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's all incorporated into the system we've got, basically.
It's Saturday, 29th of January, 2011, and I'm with Ian Pettifer and Peter Isaac.
That's right.
In Devon. So, just to start with, can you just give me an idea? Can you tell me when and where you were born? How long you've lived here? A little bit about your family?
You and me. Well,
Peter.
Right. We were born out on the top of Hennock Reservoirs, the Peat or Key, if you know where that is. Bobby Trace Lake. You know where Bobby Trace is, don't you? Oh, up on the top there. In 1924. That'll tell you something.
You were born before that, Peter. I was born before 1934.
And then father moved back to Mortar Bridge in 1928. And he farmed there till after the war.
And Ian, what about you? Were you?
I was born in Pakistan, so I'm a. You know, you want to be careful with me. My relations may be...
So what about your history with Devon? When did you get to Devon?
I came to Devon in 1951, 50 or 51, I forget now, to look for a farm.
Peter, you know, you're working and living on a farm. What are your earliest sort of childhood memories?
Pardon?
What are your earliest childhood memories of farming and...
Helping father on the farm?
Yeah.
And working with the horses before mechanisation come. Hey,
yeah.
We didn't get mechanised till 42. There's horses before that.
There's a lot of horses actually working when I started in 50.
Yeah.
I worked with horses on the farms I was student on.
And then the war come on. Well, I left school in 38. The war come on in 39. These little farmers was here before Ian. Two up the road, one horse. Then warhead come around. You just play up some land, be self-supporting. That was in the war days before you was all about. So anyway, the poor old authorities, Ian, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Not a money about. So father went out to work. Was I? That's cool. I was going out to work, see? What was my wages? God knows what, but shillings a week, wasn't it? Back in the days. So father went out to work, helping a builder up the Black Dog. I stayed home and he told me every day what I'd got to do. And Then, like I say, the war come on. Three farmers up the road here, only got one horse, so father said, "Hi, we bring one of our horses, plow up one field.
So how long would that take you? With a horse?
Well, a full horseman, he would plow an acre a day.
Slow by today.
But see, I didn't do that, right? You look after the animals home on the farm, the sheep, the bullocks. So mine was only part days.
So how many hours would you work a day then?
Huh, yeah, how many hours are you?
14, 15, 16.
Well, hardly depends up. But you didn't work from, what was I, about 7 to 5. Because look, when we're going to school, must come home every day. Father, here you boys, come out in the mango house, clean off the mango for the cows in the morning. With a hurry, get an adder, clean off the dirt off the mango. Mother's still going to school. We had 3 1/4 miles from Scotland there over to Mortimer Bishop College. Up to the college.
And you walked that every morning?
No, they were crafty. He had a brother. I've heard this tale. They shared a bicycle.
After when the education authority allowed father and mother for we had bicycles, but before that,
when she learned bicycles,
if they took us one way on the horse, then we had to walk the other way. I remember when father went us with the horse in the afternoon, 3 of us, my sister, my brother, and me, I was on the back side of the horse. 3 of us on the back of a horse. Of course, they shoveled about a bit. I slithered down over the back side of the horse. I walked the rest of the way home. I never forgot that.
But white admiral butterflies have disappeared. There probably is a reason if I knew it. But there are white admiral butterflies in woods not far from here. They can't get here. In the old days, there would have been enough hedges growing up high they could make their way along the side of a hedge because they would assume it was a wood, that they're a woodland butterfly, and they'd spread back. Unless I carry them back physically, I don't think we'll get. And yet, we've got everything that they need here, and we worry about losing butterflies or losing birds or whatever. A lot of it, birds are easier because they can at least fly to new places. Mm-hmm. But certainly things like dormice, which used to be... When I was a boy, they were fairly common. Nowadays, I don't think dormice very often can get from one dormouse habitat to another when anything goes wrong with where they are. There's not the cover. There's not
the
corridor of to get there.
Do you think this is because of the management of hedges or because we've lost so many hedges? Do you think it's because they're close-cropped? Right, okay. Yeah.
Same with the cat. The cat likes the most of it.
Oh, yeah.
I think...
Hen must be bothered to walk if he's a boy.
Mm. I mean, you could say, why bother with dormice and white admirals anyway? The answer is because... There's certainly a lot to be said for having a nice environment to work in, to having a nice environment to live in. I mean, I think you've just turned the whole of Britain into sort of one big wheat field because we're short of food in the future. It would be a pretty boring place to live, and I think we'd be very stupid, you know, to think along those lines.
How long have you been on the farm?
75 years. Yeah. Oh, you can start again? But 75 years. That's March. Father come in here then, and I've been to represent. Dennis was born there, and we're left with the family farm. I suppose things have changed from when I started. I started coming on the farm when I left school at 14, and took on horses, worked horses for 4 or 5 years. But I'd have got to learn other jobs as well. You couldn't look good for you to stand back and go, I can't do that. You told you won't do it, and to be shown what to do, and you got to stay there and do it. And old Hedges, whose father was here on his own for several years through the war and that, and things that have got three edges have got a high, so ever since that, it's been cutting off edges, tidying up. And it started with when you got a big one, big six, you could use a cross cut. And so on that power saw. And we carried on from there. Since that, the edges, when they've been laid, they've been trimmed and kept tidy. So that you've done away with all the big trees and that. Or at least there's a lot of trees left on the farm. And that is. Goes back a few years, so it's old days, but apart from that, there's just come on as this today. Well, every year you was doing edges, you do one field this year, and next year you do another around the next field, or whatever. That was, you know, then you gotta try to tarp up all the banks first. And start from the bottom and work up the tarps and square, make them up square, and then lay all your trees along the top. Well, it used to be very interesting, it used to be a nice job, I used to love it. A lot of the field edges were took out and gone. Used to be 2-3 acre fields for them, now they're 6, 10, 20 acre fields, some bigger, which is easier because you haven't got edges to look after.
And I suppose with the machinery today, you need the bigger fields.
Well, the machinery getting so big, they can't turn around in some of these little fields. They got a big field to work in. Back then, Wellington's one that, you know, one was a special thing. It was nail boots and leggings.
And what were they made from?
Leather. Well, that was all leather, heavy, leather nail boots. And you got leggings come up nearly up to your knees. And when it was raining, you had a big sack put around your waist and one over your shoulders. You hadn't got no long coats, waterproof coats. Not like there is today, no plastics or nothing like that. You just get the, you go in the morning, you get your coat. When you got your bag wet, you'd have a fresh one out for dinner. Bring in that one and hang up in somewhere and then take a fresh one and go again. And, well, you had to go out the day out to work. There was no Mr. Brennan or shining. You've got to go. Work has got to be done and there was no staying indoors.
So if you had, say, like a blackthorn hedge, did you wear gloves?
Yeah.
Did you have anything
up? I haven't got one now. I can't release it. I didn't know there was one here. Was it like a mitten. But it just got the thumb. Made a very heavy leather. Very thick leather. He was like a mitten, but he was shaped your arm. So you could just touch hold of it and just put your arm around and pull him in and and that's where that cuff on there come in on this hand. You only wear a glove on one hand.
On your left hand?
On your left hand.
And then you'd have the cuff on the right?
On the right.
To protect?
No, the irkin on the right hand. Well, I was right hand then. The irkin the right hand and the glove in the left hand. So but some was left handed, but that would be the other way around.
Actually, there's one hedge now that Roger's going to have a look at in case the AOMB want to do a demonstration like in November. So I've got banks and stone walls.
So what are your banks faced with?
They're just earth. And what they normally do is to build it up with earth and try and get an earth sod, as they call it, cut out with some grass on it, and then put it on so that it's faced with grass. And then the last one you put on, you go out in the field a bit and dig a nice turf of earth and put right on the top, and then you've got your nice green bank on it.
So is there anything growing on top of that?
Well, if you're sort of redoing a bank that's perhaps got a bit dilapidated, 9 times out of 10 there's hazel and hawthorn and that growing on it. And I mean, occasionally, such as one hedge that was done up in Ashern, between Ashern Ground and Blackpool Estate. On that hedge, there was a lot of thorn, but unfortunately the thorn was all got too old, so that had to be chopped down. They couldn't lay it. But there was also some holly trees on it. So they left the holly trees. So you got the holly trees. Well, the thorn will eventually come back again, I expect. But some of our hedges have got the upright stone wall in them. And not the flat ones, you know, you get the flat stone wall. But some of ours are done that way.
Ah, so they're sort of on their side, like that, sort of. Are they in patterns?
No, some of them are. I mean, it depends on who was doing them. So some of the men would, I suppose they'd do them their own way. But there's a wall up Cox's farm there. It's all that way.
Right.
On the edge.
Mm.
Put in so that you only see just that, like that part of it.
Well, I suppose the
biggest change is the way they actually work the ground and that. Mm. I mean, you've got so much different machinery now. They go into a field and the field's ready for tealing that day, sort of thing. Whereas years ago, when they used to do it with a horse and cart or a horse and machinery, and even when they first had a tractor and machinery, it was you'd go in and you'd do one thing today, and then perhaps tomorrow you'd go in and do something else. You know, to take you 2 or 3 days to get the field right to teal it with whatever you wanted to teal it with.
Before I left school, it must have been sort of 14, 15, we had a chap that used to come and work for us who really enjoyed his hedging, and although father did a bit with him, I was asked to go out as a lad. It was usually Saturdays because I had to be schooling there, but he'd go out Saturdays. And remember, in those days, we were doing it the old-fashioned way, which was the hedges were left up for probably 15, 20 years. Wood was the main fuel in the farmhouse, and you were cut, you were axing or cross-cutting the heavy, big timber down. And each year, you had to go around what we call the old staff hook, and you had to pare the sides to stop it growing out in the field. And my memories very much of that. You used to go probably 2 paces out from the hedge to cast up. And remember, in those days, that the biggest pest on the farm was the rabbit. I remember vividly the rabbit catcher that used to live in the village. And he came down here, and I mean, he literally put hundreds of diamonds, and they were always digging out the hedges. So yeah, from two paces out, we were always casting up, and it was probably pre the barbed wire and wire fence time. So some of them, remember too that some of the cows, before dehorning came into, and they could make a mess of a hedge, they go over and have a good old rub. So we spent a lot of time casting them up, and I remember he was called Jack Burcombe, who I went out with, and we used to laugh because he had a little three-step ladder, and it wasn't just as far as you could reach from the ground, you had to go up high enough, you had to stand on the little three-step ladder to get it up there. But yeah, it was, and there's a wonderful art in hedge laying, and you weren't cutting off everything off the top, you were leaving the hazel and the ash, some of the smaller, to steep in for that to regenerate. And I remember vividly, I mean, the farmhouse had two big open fires, and we used to cut out all the small stuff for make faggots, because that was your starting material. We used to have the old copper boiler in what was the wash house, and we had a fire under that to heat your water, because in the farmhouse at that time there was no running water, it was all from the pump in it, and hot water, there was no running water in the house at all.
So what year will we be talking about?
We would be talking about early 1950s, and it was in the era of horses. I think I'm lucky that I was able to have the opportunity to work horses in my younger days. I think the pace was so much slower than it is today, and it was very labour oriented. I mean, we made cider on the farm here, and I don't know, quite a bit of the labour, as long as they got plenty of cider, they didn't seem to worry what the wages were. And, I mean, the first memories of the first tractor hedge trimmer were something like that. It fitted on the back, and you had one chap working his socks off trying to keep, he was working probably, I don't know, 6-7 yards away from the hedge, because the tractor was driving along and you couldn't see, and then you get one big stick come into it, and then knock a blade out, because it wasn't a flail in those days, it was like the old mowers, it was just the little triangular blades, and you hit something big in the hedge, out goes the blade, so then you spend time having to rivet the blade back in again. And it, for the chap on the end, it was all right for the tractor driver, but it was blooming hard work for him at the end. And good old memories, because the other thing that I know I talked about before is that in today's world, we can't lift half hundredweight. But in those days, a sack, a West of England sack of wheat was 2¼ underweight, and we used to have to carry them up the stairs to the granary, and you were expected to do that. Now you've got a job to lift a half hundredweight because you're breaking the law. I said the old days were sweat tears, but when we were doing things like hay making, you always had time, because mother would bring out a sheet and you'd sit down and you'd have tea. The pressures didn't seem as great. You'd all have time to sit down and have tea if you'd been carrying hay the loose way, the old-fashioned way. Nowadays, the contractors come in, they go eat as they go. It's such a fast, speedy job. And I think we've lost that community spirit amongst the farming community a bit. I think I'm lucky that I can remember working the horses here. And one of the Saturday jobs was to ride, the blacksmith was in Foreign Village, which is a couple mile down the road, and once a month, I suppose, I used to ride one. They'd chuck a West of England sack over and I'd go down to Les Bowler and get your horses shoed. And it was a sort of bum experience, you know.
Big shires,
big working horses. Yeah, if you look on the, yeah.
And there's some.
And you just sit up there, bare
back. I sit up there, and off you go. And you leading the other one, you know. I was probably a little bit, I think I was about 3 or 4 on that one. I was probably 7 or 8 when I started taking that. Yeah. But it was good old days.
What we have on this hedge is a traditional way of managing hedges. We've got 15 years growth on that. We've got a crop of logs on there. We can lay down the steepers to rebuild the banks. So when we rebuild the banks, we lay down steepers, we'll see later on, and we clean out the base of the bank and put it up on the top, because all that's in the ditches at the side is eroded from the side of the banks anyway, through wind, rain and animals climbing in the hedges. Once it's chopped off, we start all over again by taking out all the big wood, the logs, pea sticks, a variety of things we can use from the hedgerows, runner bean sticks, pea sticks, you name it. It's all there, and it's such a waste for people to flail all their hedges, because farmers, where all their hedges are flailed, they're going out to buy logs, which is absolutely crazy, because they're unobtrusive, these hedges, they're up out of the way. Now we're making silage, there's no problem with drying crops, because hay can be made in the centre of the field, take the outside for silage. This is an enclosure's boundary, so everything to my left was part of the Great Ash Moor. This one, the Great Ash Moor, was enclosed in 1837, so up until the time the hedges were built and the land was separated out, the Great Ash Moor used to run from this point right down to Creakham, up to Rose Ash, and right out to Nowstone Moor. So it linked the moors, there were moors all the way through these places. And this made this hedge 30 years ago. So with 30 years of growth, we got a tremendous amount of timber to clear up. As you can see, we got logs. Like I say, and in the old days, we used to cut faggot wood, which used to go on the open fires to start them up in the morning. A big back stick on the fire dogs at the back, bit of faggot wood in the morning, bit of paraffin, flames right up the chimney, and then we laid the bigger logs on throughout the day. And those would have been cut with an axe, not with a circular saw, so they would have been about 3 foot long, laid across the dogs, and the only warmth you got was right in front of the open fire, because all the old farmhouses were so drafty, unless you were actually sat on the fire. Mother and father took pride of place, one each side, and we used to huddle around the kitchen table. So.
Right, we're now standing on top of the bank. Can you describe this for me? Tell me a little bit about it.
Yeah, what I'm showing you now is the width of the bank. It's about 2 metres wide, and once this is filled out, I will be putting other species into this, some shrub species like the Gouda Rose, the Wayfaring, Hazel, Holly, Hawthorn, Spindleberry. That will be a food supply for the bears, because bear in mind, once this one's filled, all these little twiggy pieces here, instead of buds, they'll produce roots. That is your new growth for the next hedge. Behind me, you see the standard trees. Wherever we can, we leave a standard trees, but those trees had to be growing straight from the bank. It's no good leaving trees from the tops of stumps, because they will break off. Super wide hedge, this is probably one of the widest on the farm, so I have got facilities here to enhance this one to get more species in. I think it was Peter Walker in the late 60s, 70s, said that farmers produce. We were looking at food shortages. It wasn't so long ago that the war was over and food was rationed. And it was a job to get food. Now we're a throwaway society. 25% of what we buy is thrown away. We're wasteful, really, really wasteful. And people are still starving. So we don't appreciate what we have actually. We're so lucky in Devon to have so much. We got scenery, we got food, we got no wars. I mean, we are so lucky. I can't believe that people can complain about their lot, because we are so lucky. Look around you. Fantastic.